Greetings, folks. Today we'll cover the issue of curriculum development. So this is the second part. The first you had the curriculum design, curriculum development, and that's how much I will cover for this course for the most part. However, I'll give you some prescribed reading on curriculum implementation and curriculum evaluation. So curriculum to develop, so the whole curriculum process has four stages, right? To design one, to develop, to implement, and to evaluate. So let's take today's lesson. I'll be covering six areas. That's the curriculum development process, models of curriculum development, goals of education, levels of goals, instructional objective of learning outcomes, and classifying instructional objective or learning outcomes. Okay, so let's take the first one. The first one I will be talking about the curriculum development process. So here we will be identifying curriculum is the foundation of teaching learning process, whether it's in the school, college, university, or training organization. The textbook used, how the teachers are trained, developed, or instructional plans, evaluation of students' preparation, guides of both the students and the teachers, and setting the standards are all based on the curriculum. Curriculum is the plan of ordering, directing the teaching learning experience that students encounter and in the educational institution. Finally, curriculum development is a process that continuously strives to find newer, better, and more effective means of accomplishing the task of educating the next generation. Now, the overview of curriculum developmental process is, as I told you from the beginning, and I'm repeating myself again, curriculum is not just the syllabus. It's the entire thing. It's about activity, it's about the assessment tools, it's about evaluation of learning, it's the whole thing. Okay, so keep that in mind. The second notion we would like to talk about is models of curriculum development. So if you come to the models, let's see what we have. Models of curriculum, I will be discussing today three major models. Okay, the three models are called Tyler model, Tabas model, and backward design model. The reason why I have chosen these three is, number one, Tyler's model is by far the most popular model that every curriculum book or literature talks about. It is probably the first of its kind to systematically talk about how to organize a curriculum. The Tabas model talks about a perspective from the grassroots level, so that's a unique perspective. And the backward design model, it's probably one of those most pragmatic ways to set about designing a model. So we will start off with the Tyler's model. One of the best known curriculum models is the Tyler's model, introduced in 1949 by Ralph Taylor in the classic book The Basic Principles of Curriculum and Instruction, in which he asks four basic questions. The four basic questions are, let's see, the first one is, what are the educational purpose should the school seek to attain? What educational experience can be provided that are likely to attain this purpose? And how can this educational experience be effectively organized? And finally, how can we determine whether the purpose are being attained? So basically, these are the four, right? What's the main purpose we are having a school? What are the experiences you would like your students to gain? How can this experience be effectively organized? And how do you measure this experience? So this is the four basic model that Ralph Taylor talked about. So let's take the first one. What are the educational purposes should the school seek to attain? Identifying the purpose and the objective. This is really important, okay? So by purpose, Taylor was referring to the objectives. And when developing curriculum objectives, data should be gathered from three sources, namely subject area, the learners, and the environment, okay, the awareness of the society. So you have three major parts. So obviously, for example, you may want to talk about, let's say, designing a curriculum in geography. So first, we will go and collect information on all the different geographical ideas that are suitable to be taught. Second, you would like to identify the ways or psychological principles that the learner can be engaged in a meaningful way. And finally, how the geography, knowledge, and the learner are situated within a society. So these are the three major areas that Tyler was talking about when you are considering designing a curriculum. Then the next one is identifying objectives which are desired learning outcomes. The curriculum developer has to pass them through two screens, philosophy and psychology. Remember, I was telling you this was really important because this is where you are fully aware that how philosophy, that means why we want to learn, and how we learn needs to be integrated before we decide how to execute the whole curriculum. So the second key question that Ralph Taylor asks is, what education experience can be provided that are likely to attain this purpose? So this is an important part, and what Tyler talked about is selecting the means of attaining the achievement of these objectives, i.e. the educational teaching learning experience which to be provided to the students. Okay, and then he further elaborates that four major things resulting from a specific instructional objective. Okay. Resulting in a specific instructional objective which the state the kind of outcomes that are observable and measurable. The next step is to select educational experience which are attained of stipulated objectives. The learning experience have to take into account the previous experience learners bring into the situation. And finally, the learning experience will have to be selected based on what is known about human learning and human development. The third part that Tyler talks about is how can this education experience be effectively organized. So we talk about first organizing this education or teaching learning experiences, right? Okay, so he emphasizes that experience should be properly organized so that to enhance learning and suggesting that ideas, concepts, values and skills be used as organizing elements woven into the curriculum. Okay, these elements would serve as organizing, linking content within a particular subject. Okay, and to determine the methods of instruction or delivery of content. So this is where this is very important about organizing the teaching learning experience. One way what Tyler recommends is how when we do the spiraling curriculum, you may teach the same content in parts over a longer period of time. For example, when we teach students about writing skills, we do not teach them all in 1 year. We spread them out over 3-4 years. As the spiral goes up, they learn more complex ideas. See, that's another one. The other one here, he talks about how their content is woven into a bigger fabric. In that sense is, when we organize the curriculum, let's say if you're organizing a typical first year curriculum in, let's say, architecture, you may choose subjects that are related. So when they go and acquire different learning outcomes, the outcomes can actually be woven into a bigger picture. So they are not abstract ideas that are standalone independently. They are discrete ideas, nevertheless, taught in discrete class. But when you put together, they make sense. They are kind of answer a bigger picture. So this is what Tyler was talking about, how the elements would serve as an organizing, linking content within a particular subject. Okay, so that is this part. And final part that Tyler talks about is how can we determine whether the purpose are being attained. Okay, so for that we start off with evaluating the outcomes or what have the students attained or achieved. Okay, first we evaluate. Second, we talk about necessary for educators to know whether the selected learning experience produced the intended results. So this is really important, right? If you go through a series of teaching and learning exercise without knowing whether the intended learning outcome is achieved, that will be a terrible waste of time. So that is why before we start designing the teaching and learning activity, we are supposed to be fully aware of the learning outcomes to be achieved. The second one, if the objective is to develop critical thinking among students, did the learning experience achieve the objective? Okay, and the final one is, through the evaluation, it will be possible to determine whether the curriculum was achieved effective or not. So this is the whole thing. See, evaluating the outcomes, what have the students attained or achieved is very important. This is where I feel that our lack of understanding of assessment theory sometimes come in play. Because I always hear this from people is, oh, can you give us training on how to do assessment? It is possible to give training on how to do assessment. However, the understanding the nature of the tool is really important. But what is more crucial than that is understanding why this tool is needed and where you want to implement the tools. So if you fail to understand curriculum design and you fail to understand the learning objectives or the gravity of the learning objectives, then subsequent knowledge would be futile. Because you may be excellent in designing teaching learning activities, but the design that you have achieved in your teaching learning activity doesn't lead to anything because you have not incorporated the learning outcomes in any meaningful way. And then when you do assessment, what are you assessing? Because mastering the techniques of writing action verbs, of following multiple choice exam, mastering all these techniques are great. But what is important is not that you have mastered discrete skills. What is important is these skills are used in a very, very meaningful way. And that comes from you understanding the learning outcomes in a very, very meaningful way and in a contextual way. So let's go through the overall design plan of Taylor's model, right? So Taylor says, first thing in the subject, you got to worry about three intakes. The three intakes are society, subject matter, and the learner. Is that okay? Now, once you get these three organized as a source, then you will go into mastering the objectives, setting up the objectives. Okay, but then the objectives must be careful because you must use two different connection to get the objectives right. You must understand the philosophy. That means, what is your general objective that you plan to achieve? Or why do we need to learn this? See, philosophers are always concerned about why, right? So once you want to teach, for example, in our previous example, if I say geography, you want to teach geography, right? So you will look at societal need for geography, all the different knowledge geography has contained, and how learners should learn geography. Or from the learner's perspective, what is suitable to the learner? So once you set up the objectives, then you will say, from a philosophical reason, why do you want to learn this? So this is where the whole notion of perennialism, essentialism, progressivism, and all those stuff comes in. In which way do you want to take this? And then you also have to take care of the psychological needs, right? How do you want to approach this? You want to approach this from a behaviorist perspective? Do you want to approach this from a cognitivist perspective or humanistic perspective? Or the other one that is gaining a lot of traction is constructivist perspective. So you have to use this as a screen to filter out. And then you form your instructional objectives. So the chart then flows down to selecting the learner's experience, right? So that's where once you got the instructional objective, you will now select, and this is where the real curriculum design comes in, what are the activities you're going to carry out? How are the field trips? How are the little, I remember when we're doing physical geography, the little volcanoes, the little experiments that you need to design and all this come into being. Organizing the learning experience, in which order you want to deliver. And this is really important because the sequence, epistemologically speaking, why one must come first? I mean, do you learn the formation of caves? Do you learn about natural topology? What? How do you start off? Which comes first? So this is where only a geographer designs. A geographer's point of view is very taken into seriousness because he knows how the chronology of events going to lead into it. And then finally, evaluation. Because you really need to know whether you succeeded doing the whole thing. And this comes from evaluation. And most importantly, this is not any form of evaluation. This is evaluating the objectives. At the end of the day, the objectives are achieved. We have all have criticism over the public exams that in Malaysia we conduct. If our objective is to teach problem solving in chemistry, for example, then the question must be written in a form where you can discriminate against people who have acquired and not acquired problem solving in chemistry. If it's written wrongly, you will only know who knows what, not who has the problem solving ability. So this is where the entire picture of Tyler's curriculum model comes in. Now, the second model that we would like to talk about is Thaba's model. So now, what did Thaba say? Thaba talks about this was proposed by Hilda Thaba in her book Curriculum Development, Theory and Practice, published in 1962. So this is far, about 20 years down the line. She believed that teachers who teach curriculum should participate in developing it. So this is where I was telling you why Thaba was intentionally selected, because she was coming from a counter thesis argument or counter thesis from Taylor's model, which leads to the model being called the grassroots level approach. Okay, so this is what she came. She noted there were seven major grassroots model. She noted seven major steps to her grassroots model in which teachers would have a major input. Now let's see what were the seven things that Thaba talked about. The seven things she started with, first, the diagnosis need. Okay, the teacher who is going to implement the curriculum should be able to understand her students first. So it starts off with diagnosing the need. The second one is formulation of objectives. So it is the teacher who formulates the objective. Selection of content, organization of content, selection of learning experience, organization of learning activities, evaluation and means of evaluation. So if you notice, although Thaba has broken down it in seven stages, the terminology doesn't really differ so much from Tyler, right? The only major thing that Thaba is talking about is that this seventh stage of her development comes from the teachers being the major source of input. So that is how she is different from so this is how Thaba is different from Tyler. Is although her seven stages or steps have many overlapping similar sounding terms from Taylor, but her major contribution is this whole curriculum design is very student centric, because it requires the teacher who's the closest to the student to come up with all this. Okay, then she was of the opinion that Taylor's model was more of an administrative model. So that's where she talks about how Taylor was more meant to be a top-down decision making. A greater portion of the curriculum decision were made by administrators in central office or Ministry of Education. So sad to say, in Malaysia, I mean, I don't know whether it's sad to say, but in Malaysia we are more prescriptive of Taylor's model, because if you notice, all of our curriculum comes from some central office. However, in the tertiary level, we have an opportunity to be following Thaba's decision, where the lecturer himself contributes to the curriculum design. So I guess in our context, it varies depending on what is your work of employment or place of employment. Okay, and then finally, Thaba felt that curriculum should be designed by the user of the program. Teachers should begin the process by creating specific teaching learning units for their students. And here she talks about, she advocates the teachers to take an inductive approach to curriculum development. See, inductive means, I hope you get a bigger picture of the word inductive curriculum approach, rather than just the definition of from the dictionary. See, inductive means you do not have a bigger picture until you put the piece together. Right? You are thinking, oh, this student is capable of learning of item A, item C, item D, item G, and item W, for instance. And then collating all these different items, you will have a general objective, and then that becomes the program objective. So you don't have a program objective up front. You develop what students want to learn, you organize all the different subparts, and you create the bigger picture. Whereas Tyler would have talked about a deductive approach, that means you kind of already preset, oh, these are my big objectives, these are my broad strokes I want to achieve, and then you narrow down and you organize the little activities at the bottom. So once again, as I told you, the Sataba is very onto student-centered, where the students and the teachers co-construct the curriculum and move up. Okay, this was just an option to the more traditional deductive approach. I think that's what I was talking about. Now we will talk about a third one called the backward design model. Now, it was the advocates for the backward design model is Grant Wiggins and Jay McTeer. There are three levels of decision making, unlike Taylor talked about four, Taba talked about seven, these guys talk about three, and Wiggins and McTeer list several key questions that the curriculum developer and the teacher need to raise at these stages. Okay, let's go through the first one. They talked about, it also draws from the field of architecture and engineering. They were actually very technical. They decided to take things from a very technical perspective. Backward design, we prefer to call it backward development, begins with the statement of desired results. Just what do you want to accomplish? Okay, what should the students know and be able to do? What values and attitudes should they have? What skills should they possess and be able to demonstrate? Essentially, the first stage involves identifying the school's program goals. So this is what the backward design is about. It's creating a list of what is the end goal. So it's not about I want you to learn geography. It's not about you wanting to learn history. It's about me creating a citizen who's aware of his historical upbringing and his situational position in the global world or something like that. See, you always start off with what do you want at the end? And that's what the backward design model likes to emphasize. So what the three decision-making levels are, first and most general level, an educator considers goals and check on national, state and local content standards. The second level of decision-making, the curriculum developer, including classroom teachers, select content, valuable information and skills that might lead to student to the desired results. Third, final level, decision-making is the first general stage, involves narrowing the content possibilities, what specific course should be taught, and what particular content, both declarative and procedural. So this is what they talk about. First, you need to know what is the general level. So now, for example, if I was to design a course for tertiary level, I will go and find out whether MQA have standards that I need to conform to. Or at the school level, if I would like to know what are the different regional boards have agreed, the standards have that had agreed upon by different regional levels. Okay, the second decision making is including to solicitate, right, the views of teachers to include in the decision making. Information and skills might lead to students' desired results because a whole bunch of administrators cannot successfully design an entire curriculum not knowing what actually happens in the class or what happens at the ground level. So getting first having decided the big picture, right? Then you move to the next level and find out what are the skills and what are the capabilities that the teachers and the classroom level can deliver. And then the final decision making is to start narrowing down, because if you ask someone, hey, what do you want your graduates to have, right? The list will be as someone once told me, it's the length of a string. The question is how long the string is. So you can go on forever and say, I need them to be critical thinkers. I need them to be have the ability to know things in the tip of their fingers. I need them to do this. I need them to do that. You can go on forever. But the curriculum design, the greatest skill or great curriculum designers have one ability. They have the ability to know what you can exclude without changing the outcome. Because it's very easy to throw in what you want. But if you start throwing what you want, the list will be infinite. And you have finite resources, right? So that's where the difference between a good curriculum. He knows that if you remove some of these things, you will not change the outcome. And that is, I guess, the skill of crafting a good curriculum comes about. So this is the three levels of decision making that the backward design emphasizes. Okay, the next thing that Wiggins and McTaggart were list several key questions that the curriculum developer and the teacher needs to raise at this stage. Okay, they are, what, let's start with the first one, what knowledge and skills that the student needs to succeed in this course. Okay, what activities will enable students to master the requisite knowledge and skills? What should be taught and how should it be taught for students to become knowledgeable and skillful in the identified content realm? What materials will foster students' success in the curriculum? Does the overall design of the course and the unit fulfill the principles of curriculum development? Finally, backward design model gets the teachers to think like an assessor before the curriculum unit and lesson. Now, I guess this is where one of the strengths of McTaggart and Wiggins model, or the backward design model, is that teachers who, before they design the big picture, these are the big questions they need to ask. Now, if a teacher is teaching a course and he participates in the curriculum design, he kind of already have a bigger picture of what his graduates will achieve at the end of the course, or what his students will able to master, perform, and deliver at the end of the perform by asking these 6-7 questions that they have proposed. Okay, now we will cover the goals of education. Okay, the first part is, some decisions are relatively simple, such as adding a course, deleting a course, or making some minor changes to the content. Other decisions are sweeping and far-reaching, such as changing the level of schooling. For example, in Malaysia, we have 6-3-2-2 system. We have 6 years of primary school, 3 years of Form 1 to Form 3, what we call middle school. We have 2 years of high school, which is Form 4 and Form 5. And then we have 2 years of pre-university, Form 5, lower 6 and upper 6. Or in some countries, they may have a 6-4-2 system, right? I think this is something like the American system. You have 6 years, grade 6, then you have 4 years of secondary school and 2 years of pre-U, junior college, and things like that. Now, the question is, how do you make this decision? This decision was made by someone. And how do you justify that this decision? How do you know this decision produces the best results and not anything else? The next thing you may want to talk about is, how does the one decides all the three models of curriculum development emphasize the needs from the onset to plan statements of purpose for the education system? What do you want the students to able to do after completing primary school, or after completing secondary school, or even after finishing a degree in engineering? What do you want the students to do? So all three models, whether it's Taba, Tyler, or the backward design, you really need to describe first the justification of education. That means at end of completing the entire experience, the rituals of going through your system, what do you want them to be able to do? And then the final one would be, the curriculum planner will have to decide on an education philosophy from which the goals of education may be derived. So once again, we have talked a lot about this in the beginning and it keeps coming back. You need to know why you're doing it. See, to design a curriculum, it will be good for knowing what you can do upon finishing the schooling system. And most importantly, you need to know why you are able to do all this. Okay? Now, let's talk about the levels of goals. Now, the level of goals, we have approximately 6 levels of goals. Okay. First, we will start off, obviously, with always, we will start off with the educational philosophy. Now, educational philosophy, there are 4 important issues that we need to talk about. Initially, the initial task of curriculum planners is identification of an educational vision or philosophy which will be form the basis of the planning. See, this is where I've told you repetitively in our workshops, in our classroom meetings, and so on and so forth, that if you can't get the initial stage, that means the philosophies, approach, and all this correct, then subsequently you will start contradicting yourself. So you need to get the philosophy right. Second is the vision statement or philosophy provides guidelines for curriculum development in organizing and incorporating programs and activities into a curriculum. And thirdly, it reformulates the light of reality that enabled vision to be achieved through process of learning in school rather than remaining an ideal that is unachievable. And fourthly, educational philosophy will also reflect the national priority. So there are a few things that we need to worry about. The national priority in our case is common national curriculum in reducing varying interpretations, free primary education to reduce dropouts, use one language of instruction to unite the different communities. The educational philosophy of the educational system is the reflection of the national policy. Should the emphasis be on basic education? Does the country want more graduates or develop the needs? Have to identify the relations of to the priorities, levels of achievement of children of different cycles, and social cultural needs and social cultural needs of people. Okay, now let's go back and read. Let me give you my take on this. Okay. So when I mean by education philosophy, I said initially the curriculum planners need to identify a vision. So you must have a sight of where you want to go, right? Only then you know how to pick up the pieces, the direction, and the mode of transportation, and so on and so forth. Because once you can, if you know where you want to go, then you can provide all the guidelines to the curriculum development. Because most importantly, you need to formulate the realities. How do you get there? What are the real things can be achieved? Because you don't really want to develop a curriculum that at the end of the day doesn't achieve its target, right? You can't evaluate, you can't measure, because it's so unrealistic. You really need to get those things right. And finally, you need to get your priorities right. So in many cases, there are a few things that, for example, even a national priority need to ask. The questions are, is there going to be a common national curriculum? For example, in this case, I'm preparing for the school division, free primary education. Okay, free primary education. And how do you drop out that? Even this coincides the video prior to this. We talked about how in Malaysia, in order to do this, we have given people's own language as the fundamental to reduce dropout. So people in early age of education can choose whether they want to attend primary school in Chinese, in Tamil, in Malay, or religious schools. So they could have a choice. And the overall philosophy is to make sure that everybody goes to school, or at least everybody goes to some form of early primary school. Then we talked about the use of, we talked about the use of different language. And now, you know, particularly the maths and science have drawn a lot of attention. But once again, it comes back to this, the use of language. Education philosophy of an education reflects the national policy. So this is the thing. What do you want to identify as national policy? Should the emphasis be on basic education? Should the emphasis be on accelerated education? See, when you design a for educational policy, do you want to cater for the fundamentals so that you know that the lowest common denominator is of reasonable high standard? Or remember, we talked about how in certain countries like India and Russia, the education system was catering for the elite. It was always getting the best out of you. So when you are trying to get the best out of you, only the best survives. You know, remember that discussion that we had prior to this. So these are the things that we are talking about. Does the country want more graduates? Like in Malaysia, the current prime minister some years ago has decided that one of his measurement target will be have 60% of the population to be graduates. So then subsequently, the policies to have private education come in, or increasing the number of colleges, increasing the universities, increasing the notion of different courses, or really to facilitate this philosophy or this notion of getting more graduates. Developing the needs of to be identified relation to the priority, levels of achievement of different cycles, what do you want to do in the first 10 years, what do you want to do in the next 20 years, because you can't have the same education system forever, right? So you go in cycles. And mostly social economic needs of the people. Okay, so this is where we will cover, or this is what I would like to cover for this notion of educational philosophy under the level of goals. Now, The next stage we will go through is educational goals. Okay, what are the, I'm sorry, this keeps moving up and down. Okay, educational goals. So under the notion of educational goals, you have four major points. They are education goals are outcomes to be achieved by students at the end of a particular period of time. So that's the goal, right? This means that a child will be facing different goals at different levels. The goals are basic elements in the curriculum planning and should be clear and well articulated without ambiguity. Now, this is where the, I would say, a lot of problem lies, without ambiguity, right? Now, how do you have an unambiguous learning outcome when very, very explicit? Then remember, as we talked about in our class, when it's very explicit, then you draw, you kind of come into the thin borderline of between education and training. So, but nevertheless, a goal, in order to be measured, it needs to be unambiguous. And then you have to relate to human behavior. The goal itself needs to be measurable and predictable. So, for example, recovering from civil war, its key educational goals might be to be placed a developing self-confidence, cooperative, responsible citizens need to overcome the existing conflicts. So in Malaysia, when, you know, this is what's the scenario we were recovering. So the one of the goals is to relate to human behavior. For example, there could be a country recovering from civil war. Its key educational goal might be peace, developing self-confidence, cooperation, responsible citizenship needs to overcome existing conflict. On the other hand, there could be a need for a particular country, could be a whole bag full of goals such as developing creativity, mental health, cope change, informed participation, basic skills, and so on and so forth. Ending the vision of cultural needs of society. There could be another one connecting development needs to education as an important strategy to achieve greater impact of education to society. So the goals should be related to the human behavior. Okay. So once again, the education goals, there are four, and most importantly, they all should come related to the human behavior, because you can't have a non-behaviorist goal, whether you like it or not. Now, the next one will be curriculum goals. Okay, curriculum goals. Curriculum goals. A curriculum goal is a proposal or a desired end statement in general terms. So the curriculum has a goal, right? Because in order for you to start a journey, you need to know where the journey ends. So the journey itself is called the curriculum goal. It has to have a general term, saying by end of this, the student will be able to do this, or have acquired this, or able to demonstrate this. So your statement, the curriculum goal is a purpose of desired end stated in a general term. The next one is, no time period is specified when the goal must be reached. Neither is mentioned of the criteria achievement mastery. The curriculum planners expect students to accomplish it as a result of exposure to the segment or all programs of a particular educational institution, and goals provide direction of the curriculum. Okay. Students shall acquire knowledge and skills necessary for functioning as good citizens in their own school and community. School should seek to promote physical and emotional health of students. So these were key important goals. Okay, once again, let me review the curriculum goals. Very important, right? Because you need to get this right. The curriculum goal is a purpose or a desired end state in general terms. So you would like to say that I would like to, for example, by end of this journey, reach Tanjung Malim. But you don't want to go into very specific by saying that I will reach Tanjung Malim in 30 minutes. No. Because what happens is then you become a very technical curriculum. You, in order to have a broader curriculum, you do not want to specify certain things, because then you kind of hijack the whole notion of teaching and learning process. So a curriculum must have an end state, but there shouldn't be no times. Neither mention criteria of achievement. For example, coming back to my first example, my goal is to reach Tanjung Malim. I wouldn't want to say that I'll reach Tanjung Malim in 30 minutes. And I wouldn't want to say that when I reach Tanjung Malim is when I reach to my favorite mama's stall in this address. Because Tanjung Malim could be a broader area, not a particular shop that I would like to go to. Okay. So these are the few things that the curriculum goal, it needs to be broad. It needs to give room for people to come in at different stages and acquire different skill, a broader notion of skills and knowledge. Now, after finishing talking about curriculum goals, we will talk about curriculum objectives. Remember, objectives are much more specific. Goal is to tell you the big picture, where do you want to go or where do you want to hit end of this. So that's the curriculum goal. Now, curriculum objective, on the other hand, allows you to be very specific. But this is where I would say the rubber hits the road. This is where you have to tell exactly all the different things that are going to take place. So to start off with, curriculum objectives are derived from curriculum goals. Makes sense? Curriculum objective is the purpose and end stated in a specific measurable terms. Now, whether you like it or not, this is how objectives need to be written. Because if you're unable to measure a very specific way, then you wouldn't know you have achieved. See, if you know the objective is to get to Tanjung Malim to eat chapati, then if you know you would have achieved when you have reached, crossed the border of Selangor, got into Perak, and you are in a town approximately called Tanjung Malim, and you are in a shop eating chapati, then you know you have reached the curriculum objective. So it needs to be very measurable. Okay, the next level would be, it is a refinement of the curriculum goals. Okay, because once again, you need to always relate it back to the goal, right? The curriculum goal itself. Now, they specify the performance standard for the students from whom the curriculum is designed. So in my case, I would say that if my goal was to reach Tanjung Malim and my objective was to reach Tanjung Malim to this particular shop to eat chapati, then I would know I've achieved the curriculum objective and I'm in the shop eating a chapati that is reasonably tasty, for example. And then the curriculum goal, students shall acquire knowledge and skills necessary for functioning on daily basis, a good citizen in their own school and communities. Setting the following curriculum objectives can be derived. So now, once again, the objective is up to us, whoever is designing curriculum. What are the end objective? If it's to design a curriculum, a citizen, then to have values that a good citizens have. If it's to design a good mechanical engineer, then he will have the KSA, knowledge, skills, and aptitude of a good chemical or mechanical engineer. Okay. Now, the sub-points for this is the majority of students will obey the rules and regulation of the school, in this case, citizenship, right? More than 80% of students will be involved in at least one voluntary activity. So this is how you know that you have achieved good citizenship. Note that the curriculum objective refines the curriculum goal. Many curriculum objectives can emanate from one curriculum goal. So, if your curriculum goal was to create a professional chemist, right? That is a curriculum goal. But your curriculum objective is, what does professional chemist mean? There are maybe six steps or six characteristics of a professional chemist. So, you could operationalize the six objectives in order to achieve the single curriculum goal. So, next we have is the instructional goal. And the instructional goal is, at the instructional phase, curriculum objectives are translated initially into instructional goals. The instructional goals is a statement of performance expected of each student in a class stated in general terms. It is the general intention of the course of instruction without criteria or achievement. And then you can sub that into... One second, it should open up now. Yeah, for example, students will show an understanding about tropical rainforests. It indicates that performance expected, i.e. understanding, but performance level or criteria not stated. So it is not easily measured. Instructional goals points the way of the instructional objective. Okay, now instructional goal again is the same thing as the curriculum goal. You don't want to start very early telling you exactly what you want to achieve, because it's the same thing. We are always giving opportunity when the person is instructing a group of students to allow him to achieve the specific measure, specific behavior according to certain freedom. For example, depending on his background of a student, he may be able to stretch the understanding further and basically to give them the leeway. So you don't want to start off your instructional goals so specific. Now the final one is instructional objectives. Same as the what we had, the difference between curricular goal and curriculum objective. Now you have instructional goals and instructional objective. Now instructional objective, your job is to be very specific. Because this is where, when it's operation, see, instructional goal is probably, if you want to take a very simplistic goal, the instructional goal is written at a very high level. This is what we expect the instructors to do. Then the instructional objective is written at a local level where you know these are the resources you have, these are the quality of teachers you have, this kind of the competency of students that are already in your class, and this is how you will execute. So instructional objective is could be written at a much more lower level so that they are specified or customized to a particular setting. Okay, so now instructional objective is a statement of performance to be demonstrated by each student in the class. Okay, so what we have there, we have it states in a form that is measurable and observable. Now whether you like, and we are depending on your philosophical approach, now school system is it's like any other system, it is accountable. And when you say accountable, one of the way to demonstrate delivery is to measure the observables. So this is where the instructional goal objective needs to be written in a form where it is very easy for you to justify the activity has taken place. Okay. The next one is the other names given for instructional objective are specific instructional objective, specific learning outcomes, behavioral objective, performance, activities, competencies. These are different nomenclatures basically reflecting on instructional objective. Then you have an example of an instructional objective. At the end of this lesson, students would be able to describe 5 characteristics of tropical rainforest. See, it's as explicit as that. They want 5. They don't want you to describe a rainforest. They want you to describe what are the 5 characteristics of rainforest. So they are talking about very specific definition. Okay, and then it's important that you state clearly that the instruction objectives you intend to achieve at the end of the period of instruction. See, people need to know that that's the end. I mean, if the story goes on and on and on, you will never know that is the objective. So you need to be very explicit, and you need to know, people need to know when the story has ended. Okay, so obviously, that is a very key feature of the instructional objective. The next thing we would like to discuss here is, it determines the selection of content. So you need to know, because I told you this is done on a micro level, right? So you need to know the kind of textbooks you have, the internet, the connectivity, the speed of connection you have in your campus, and then the reference books and so on and so forth. So the determination of selection of content needs to be also done at this stage. Then you have the teaching and learning methods. Lectures, practical sessions, group discussions, self-study, field visits. So for example, in tertiary education, you have great flexibility in deciding how many parts of your notional hour will include lecture, how many parts of its group discussion, how many parts of it is self-study, field visits, and so on and so forth. So you have to design the learning activities to suit the learning objectives. Then you talk about learning resources. You have what are the resources available besides what I mentioned earlier. You also have the more traditional for school, and is generally available at the school level. You have audio, visual, aids, equipments, and kits, and so on and so forth. Okay, and finally, this new paradigm that talks about e-learning. Now, of course, each of us have our own interpretation and definition of what e-learning is. So the idea is how much of e-learning is going to be incorporated in the instructional objectives. Okay, the next one is the instructional objective learning outcomes. Now, I've given a separate section, although we talked a little bit about this in the earlier section, because by for most part, curriculum developers need to be aware that this is the actual part that is generally debated about in the public space. Instructional objective and learning outcomes. Because this is how you know why you are going into the class day in, day out. What is your main purpose? Is to deliver the instruction, is to participate in the instructional objective and achieve the learning outcome. Now, we will start off with the first one. Instructional objectives are learning outcomes desired and are primary importance in developing a curriculum. This is very important for us to get it. Instructional objectives are the learning outcomes desired and the primary importance of developing curriculum. Because if you don't get this in the beginning of class, right, how do you distinguish an entertaining lecturer and an effective lecturer? An entertaining lecturer could keep you laughing in stitches, right? He could be having such a fun time in his class. But end of the day, you need to ask, has the instructional objective met? Have I acquired the learning desired learning outcomes? Now, an effective teacher, on the other hand, has this well-balanced ability of keeping you engaged at the same time making sure that you have an opportunity to absorb and engage and participate and, most importantly, acquire the learning outcomes. And the second one, objectives point to an appropriate content to be selected, how teaching and learning is to be conducted, and ways of assessing performance of this objective. So that's a very important part of the objectives, instructional objective. In the past, traditional description of a course simply refers to content. What was the teacher would cover? So this is where the more accountable curriculum is. When you are very specific, you do not say, today we are going to do Newton's third law. So, whereas a properly crafted instructional objective or learning outcome would be, by end of this lesson, the student will be able to understand Newton's third law, will able to demonstrate some of these, you know, calculations or some of these concepts, or able to solve problems from this dimension or this area. So, they need to be very explicit rather than saying, today we will cover this, tomorrow we will cover this, and it's just going through a list, because you need to have the behavioral objective very well crafted that you know that you have achieved. The next one is there is, however, been a shift in thinking about teaching and learning, which the learner and the learning and the learner now seem to be the primary importance. See, once you have this behavioral outcome very well crafted, right, the shift systematically shifts from teaching to learning. Because if you are just describing the traditional approach to learning objectives, instructional objective, the instruction will be completed when the last sentence of the lesson plan has been delivered. But now shifting the paradigm towards the learning objective, then the instruction is only ends when the last learner in the class have acquired the learning outcome. So teaching becomes a means of facilitating learning in the learner. So this is a major shift. And this is, I mean, as I said, it takes a long time if you understand curriculum design, because we constantly hedge on our historical traditions, right? So although philosophically and generally speaking, we would like to engage students at this level, but many of our classroom lecture does not cater for this, or it's yet to evolve, because we haven't seen a very matured classroom yet. Many of us are gradually shifting from lecturing and towards facilitating. Because, as I said, how do I know my lecture is completed? If I was faithful to this philosophy, I will know my lecture is completed when every one of y'all demonstrate certain behavior that I already predetermined. Not when I finish talking. And if you see in my class, I'm also an hypocrite. I generally try to engage many of y'all, but I end my lesson when I have nothing else to say for the day. not after every one of you all have demonstrated the behavior. So as I said, it's a long way. We are all part of the learning curve, but this is what this instructional objective is talking about. So the next one we would like to talk about is the teacher-centered approach. Okay, the teacher-centered approach generally talks about teaching in generally seem to be about transmission knowledge. Focuses on the teacher, well, focusing on what the teacher did, and the goals and subjects are where expression in terms of content which the teacher would transmit. So this is your traditional teacher-centered approach. So now the question is, you need to be judge of my class. Am I teacher-centered? That means I just focus purely on transmitting knowledge. I come in class, I blah 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 blab my mouth for 3 hours, and when I'm done transmitting, I dismiss the class and leave. So this is a very traditional approach. And if, to be fair, if you look around you, almost all education institutions, for most part, still whether we speak against it or not is one thing, but generally still practice a big part of our teaching learning enterprise around the teacher-centeredness. The next part we would like to talk about is the learner-centered approach. Now, a genuine learner-centered approach has the following characteristics. Okay, the statement describing the change in student behavior. So the general approach must be, the student must be able to demonstrate this. Because we assume prior to this lesson, the students were not able to demonstrate a particular concept. Now the student, upon finishing your class, will be able to demonstrate such a behavior, which should result from taking the course known as intended learning objectives or intended learning outcomes, objectives and outcomes for short. So because they have participated in the course, they are now able to achieve the particular objective or particular outcome. And then you have teaching then becomes a series of strategies which are drives in order to help students achieve these objective outcomes. You will notice that at the beginning of each chapter of this course, there is a list of learning outcomes and objectives. You see, many traditional textbooks, especially the modern ones, will describe the outcomes to be achieved upon reading this chapter. Okay, the focus is on what the learner does, and the intentions of the subject area are usually expressed in terms of how the learner will be changed as the results of learning the content. So this is the learner-centered. You really need to get this right, because otherwise you will be performing lip service to the learner-centered curriculum, because everybody talks about this. But the question I would like you to ask is, how much of the ritual of the whole teaching learning exercise, when you go into class, you say students, and to the last sentence, thank you very much for coming to today's lesson. I mean, from this whole, the beginning to the end, right? How much of the entire approach is bagged in the student-centered learning approach? Because it's very easy to say that I am practicing student-centered. We kind of throw in here a few activities here and there for the sake of getting students engaged, but at the end of the day, can you measure the students' transformation after attending this class? Remember, teaching, there's two approaches. You have transmitting and transformation. So the teacher-centered approach is focusing on just purely transmission, whereas the student learner-centered will be about transformation. So learning has only taken place after the transformation has taken place. In stating the instruction, objectives or learning outcomes achieved, verbs are used to indicate that the students must do in order to demonstrate learning. I think this is where I spent a lot of time in one of the workshops, describing from Bloom's taxonomy, the action verbs and the different levels and the three domains. You have the cognitive, psychomotor and the affective domains. And then it is not enough to say, yes, I understand that, but how do I know that you understand unless you can demonstrate that you can do? Here are some examples of learning outcome. So you have on completion of this 45-minute lesson on the tropical rainforest, you should be able to For example, define the terms of evergreen, humidity, buttress, roots, canopy. Then you have locate the distribution of rainforest in the world map and explain why there is little undergrowth in the rainforest. So you have specific ways of measuring the students upon completing the 45-minute lesson. So this is what we talk about, the instruction objectives and learning outcomes. As I said, this is really important, folks, because this is how this is where the rubber hits the road. Because you can describe the car, I mean, you have very good engine, we have very good drivers, very good, all this stuff, right? But actually what moves the car is the traction between the tire and the road. If you can't get that going, all the engine revolution, RPM, torque will be just gone wasted, because the torque that transfers through the axle comes to the wheel, and the wheel is the actual part that transfers the energy to make the car move. So you really need to get this instructional objective learning outcome, the different approaches, student-centered learning, the teacher-centered learning, and the chapter, the extra sheet that I gave you in the workshop previous lesson should really come in handy for this. So the final part I would like you to pay attention is to classifying instructional objective and learning outcomes. And we do this by going to our favorite friend of all time called Bloom's. So Bloom's talked about how things can be classified in three dimensions, or the triangulation of skills. You have the cognitive domain, the affective domain, and the psychomotor domain. I think I will leave it up to you to discover this. I'm sure the web has lots of resources that talks about these three. Most importantly, I need you to pay attention to not just the levels, but the general active verbs that are associated at each level. However, having said, it's very difficult to find a curriculum, mostly, especially in the tertiary level, that has good marriage between all the three fields. We are predominantly a cognitive domain industry. However, I believe in primary and secondary, this is not true. There's lots of opportunity to systematically incorporate psychomotor and affective domain. Okay. Now, this is a summary of the curriculum development. Remember the first day, the first prior video prior to this is curriculum design. We talked about all the different rules or design that need to incorporate. And here is how do you actually get things done. So we talked about initially the curriculum development process, where the whole process is about how do you incorporate the whole thing, right? The teaching learning exercise, the textbooks, the materials, and so on and so forth. Then we talked about the models of curriculum. There was three major models. You have the Tyler model, Taba model, and the backward design model. That obviously this is not extensive, but these are the key models that generally talked about in literature. Then you have educational goals, talking about why we have the structure that we have, and what is the end outcome of participating through this structure. Then you have levels of goals, which we have the levels from a philosophy point, we have levels from the educational goals, then we have the levels at the curriculum goals, then you have curriculum objectives, which is very important because this is where how the curriculum is brought alive. You see, the goals talk about the grand things, grand targets, but the objective talks about the actual outcomes that are produced. Same thing goes with instruction. You have the instructional goals, and most importantly, you have the instructional objectives. Then I come to, and I specialize, I gave you a full mind map on instructional objective and learning outcomes. And finally, we talked about how do you classify the objectives, and that we rely purely on Bloom's taxonomy and a few other taxonomies, but generally Bloom is taken to be the father of, or taken, Bloom's work is taken, considered greatly by many academics. And Bloom talks about how the knowledge can be derived from three taxonomies. You have the cognitive domain, the affective domain, psychomotor domains. So as I mentioned earlier, please make sure that you take some effort to identify the levels and the action verbs that are associated with each level. Thank you very much.